Our speaker for today is Dr. Abhijit Ahuja. Dr. Abhijit Ahuja is an interventional pulmonologist practicing in various hospitals in Mumbai, which include Saifi Hospital, Bhatia Hospital, and Sushrut Hospital. He holds a European diploma in respiratory medicine and has presented various papers at national and international conferences. He would be talking about balloon bronchoplasty in airway stenosis. So balloon bronchoplasty is widely performed to dilate airway structure, which are caused by tuberculosis, cancer, and other inflammatory conditions. Depending on the severity, the procedure can be administered both via daycare procedure or under general anesthesia. But what does a successful catheter balloon dilation of tracheal and bronchial stenosis look like? Let's hear from our expert. Welcome, Dr. Ahuja.
Hi, thank you for the kind information and the good introduction to me, and a small gist as to what I'm going to be explaining for the next half an hour. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Abhijit Ahuja. I'm a trained interventional pulmonologist practicing in various hospitals across South and Central Mumbai. I'll be speaking about balloon bronchoplasty in airway stenosis. What is balloon bronchoplasty? It's a simple, direct, and minimally traumatic approach which uses balloons for dilatation of airway stenosis. It may be used alone or in conjunction with other bronchoscopic therapies to dilate airway stenosis and restore adequate airflow. Why do we talk about dilating airway stenosis? How are they caused? So there are malignant as well as non-malignant causes for airway stenosis in adults as well as children. If you speak about the malignant causes, there are you can group them into endoluminal tumor growth or intrinsic airway compression caused by cancer growing within the airways, as well as endoluminal tumor growth or extrinsic airway compression by metastatic cancers which are around the airways. So the structures around the airways, for example, thyroid, the carcinoma would be impinging upon the airway, causing a stricture. Or tumors in adjacent structures like larynx, thymoma, germ cell tumors, lymphomas in the mediastinum can also be a cause of airway stenosis. In non-malignant diseases, you've got, I can actually differentiate the airway stenosis as per the cause in terms of iatrogenic, that is post-intubation tracheal stenosis, post-tracheostomy tracheal stenosis, infectious tuberculosis being quite common in India is also a cause for airway stenosis. It's usually seen affecting either the bronchial tree as well as the trachea itself. There are certain congenital causes as well, which lead to sling stenosis, webbed or vascular anomalies. And in the autoimmune or inflammatory causes, there are Wegener's granulomatosis, fibrosing mediastinitis, sarcoidosis, amyloidosis, etc. Patient would present in, with breathlessness, not responding to bronchodilator therapy, or having a monophonic or a unilateral wheeze, sometimes even presenting to you as stridor. Orthopnea and platypnea is uncommon, and recurrent infections on non-resolving pneumonias are often found to be airway strictures or stenosis on bronchoscopic examination. Else, it is a good idea to actually evaluate the airways if you are coming across non-resolving pneumonias. How do you assess the lesion suitability? A CT scan would give you most of the data, and bronchoscopy also is necessary to determine suitability of the lesion for bronchoplasty. Lesions best suited for balloon dilatation are symptomatic and benign stenosis, or those that have failed or are not suitable for medical therapy targeted at the underlying cause. For example, antimicrobial treatment for TB or immunosuppressive medications for sarcoid. Most successful are the ones with benign fibrotic lesions, those due to prolonged intubation. And this is because these are mostly iatrogenic. You can pick them up earlier. You can provide the therapy much sooner rather than secondary to tracheobronchial malacia, inflammation, or cancer. Lesions that are less suitable for this procedure are those associated with ulceration or mucosal fragility, because there is a risk of rupture when you go about dilating these strictures, and vascular lesions should probably be avoided because of the risk of rupturing the vessels. Surgical approach would be better in these. Coming to some amount of classification for the airway obstructions, can be grouped into concentric and bottleneck airway obstruction. As you can see here, In the first figure, in A, there's a narrow ring-like obstruction that involves a short segment of the airway as opposed to a bottleneck obstruction, which involves a longer section. A longer segment with tapering, which is superiorly and inferiorly tapering. Bottleneck lesions are less likely to be responsive to balloon dilatation as they are more likely to be associated with loss of supporting cartilage. So here you can see that the cartilage is intact. So whatever therapy you have to give within the airways will be supported by the cartilages. Here, if there is a loss of cartilage, even if you go about dilating the stricture, it will fall back in it. Concentric shaped stenosis may also be better suited to dilatation than bottleneck shaped lesions, since the latter are generally associated with loss of supporting cartilage. There's no real limit regarding the length of stricture that can be dilated. If it is more long, can be done in multiple settings or gradually also in the same sitting. Coming to the anatomy of the bronchial tree, if you can see the primary or the first generation bronchi and the second generation bronchi, which are the lobar bronchi, can be easily dilated with the stenosis present in these areas. Those who are in the subsegmental bronchi or even the segmental bronchi are difficult to actually get into maneuver as well as try and dilate. So you really can't access them. So you really can't offer the therapy to these tertiary or quaternary airways. What are the contraindications to the therapy? Similar to those seen in flexible or rigid bronchoscopy, including the decision to withhold anticoagulants, antiplatelets. Also contraindicated if you can't visualize the airway beyond the lesion or the channel through the stenosis too narrow to be able to pass a guide wire or even a balloon. Since the procedure requires the passage of a guide wire beyond the stenosis in order to be successful, if you are looking at the guide wire technique, you would need to visualize the airway beyond. Intubation and mechanical ventilation is not a contraindication to the procedure. It's actually a bridge. You can extubate the patient on table once the therapy is given. So talking about some contraindications to bronchoscopy that most of you would be aware of. Efficacy. Rates of immediate success defined as improved airway patency upon direct visualization by bronchoscopy and short-term success, that is 2 to 6 weeks, are high, with improved airway patency seen radiologically as well as bronchoscopically in terms of the symptoms and the lung functions. However, long-term success beyond that is unpredictable. Sometimes multiple dilatations are needed subsequently to maintain a satisfactory result. Most of the benign strictures usually do need more than one sitting. Sometimes if they do need more than one sitting, you can also think of offering stenting to the same lesion to give a longer term symptom-free benefit to the patient. In general, only fibrous stenosis can be reliably improved with balloon dilatation alone. Additional therapies like cautery are often needed in conjunction from balloon dilatation with other causes. To dilate the lesion, you need to first give an incision so that you can introduce a balloon of a varying length as well as diameters. Coming to the technique of the procedure. The bronchoscopist should be trained and skilled in the procedure as well as in other procedures. As we use in conjunction with other procedures along with the balloon dilatation, for example, electrocautery, cryo, or even laser. Generally, at least two staff are required. One, the bronchoscopist itself, to the bronchoscopic equipment, a staff needed to operate that, and another to administer medications or operate a fluoro or inflate or deflate the balloon. Patients typically require some sort of established airway depending on the location and experience and the planned intervention. A laryngeal mask airway, an endotracheal tube, or a rigid bronchoscope is what you can use. With the exception of a very distal stenosis, patient comfort during dilatation necessitates a deep degree of sedation or anesthesia. If the stricture is present into the secondary bronchus, patient would not be as breathless on table. Can be attempted to do the dilatation under local anesthesia as well as mild sedation. However, some sort of anesthesia should always warranted, as the we are dealing with the airways, the patient is bound to feel some amount of suffocation. In some patients, balloon dilatation is performed via the flexible bronchoscope with topical anesthesia and procedural sedation, especially in distal stenosis. The necessary equipment includes that required for bronchoscopy, an appropriately sized balloon catheter or guide wire, and an electrocautery probe or laser for if required for giving radial incisions and introducing the balloon. Pre-oxygenation is helpful, especially for tracheal lesions, since the airway will be temporarily obstructed at the time of balloon inflation. Hence, pre-oxygenating these patients is a good idea, as you are going to be causing a small amount of apnea for a minute or less than a minute to dilate the lesions. A selection of balloon catheters of different diameters should be available prior to the procedure. Sequential dilatation with catheters of increasing diameter is common and gives you a good outcome. Initial balloon catheter size is pre-selected based upon the length and the diameter of the stenosis and post-procedural dimensions. Coming to the length of the balloon, should protrude enough to reach the end of the stenosis so that the dilation of the entire lesion occurs upon the inflation of the balloon. If it is too long, if you are crossing the stenosis going across, it might damage the uninvolved airways, the normal airways. If it is too short, it will tend to slip out of the stenosis upon inflation, so it will not do the job. The length of the balloon is typically at least more than half centimeter of the stenotic segment. So a 2.5 to 4 centimeter long balloon is usually adequate if you are looking at the adult trachea or a segmental bronchi. You need to assess the lesion with a check bronchoscopy prior to the main procedure and try and gauge the length of the lesion so you can plan the procedure accordingly. The required length of the balloon is estimated by CT studies as well, as and passing the bronchoscope beyond the stenosis and measuring the distance between the proximal and distal limits of the obstruction. Balloon diameter needs to be larger than that of the lesion for dilatation to occur. Should not be so large that excessive airway injury results. There are certain complications that arise out of this that I will be coming down to. Generally chosen to be the same as that of the lumen measured at the proximal region of the normal airway. So if you are looking at, for example, a left main bronchial stenosis, you can see the stenotic segment, also compare it to the normal airway, probably on the right, and then use the appropriate balloon. Should start with a relatively small diameter balloon and subsequently progressively larger balloons. The required width can be estimated from CT images as well, or by comparing the bronchoscopic diameter to the stenosis. If you are able to pass the stenosis, how easily you are able to pass the stenosis also gives you an idea. Here's a non-conformer balloon. This is a balloon which is dilated over a guide wire, and this one is a deflated balloon. With radiopaque markers at the balloon ends. So this one is usually passed through the flexible bronchoscopic channel itself. This one can be done too, but this is undone over the guide wire, depending on the technique that you would want to prefer. This is the dilator gun with the pressure gauge, because when you inflate the balloon, every balloon has a tag here which shows the atmospheric pressures it needs to be inflated to attain that kind of diameter. Here's a balloon catheter passed via the working channel of a flexible bronchoscope, which is inserted into the airway via LMA. Here I can explain to you via the diagrammatic representation of how we are going to go about doing balloon dilatation with a guide wire technique. A guide wire is passed across the stenotic segment here using bronchoscopy as well as fluoroscopy to ensure the guide wire does not extend to the pleura. You might end up perforating the airway here, and it might probably end up going to the pleura. And then the bronchoscope is withdrawn, leaving the guide wire in place. The balloon catheter is advanced over the guide wire and placed over the stenotic segment under fluoro guidance. Proper positioning at the proper proximal end of the balloon is confirmed by a visualization with the bronchoscope, And bronchoscopic also, you need to keep the bronchoscope in the airway to see the direct monitoring of the balloon inflation and deflation with bronchoscopy or with fluoroscopy. Nowadays, with the advent of video bronchoscopy, the predilection towards using a fluoroscopic technique has gone down, as we are able to do the procedure in real time, look at the lesion as well as the dilatation happening real time. For example, this is a video in which we are passing the balloon dilators through the stenotic segment. The entire balloon has been passed through the stenotic segment with saline, which has been instilled into the airway. You can see here the left main bronchus is stenosed. Balloon has been inflated. After holding for around 30 seconds to about a minute or even sometimes more, the balloon is gently withdrawn. And you can see the dilatation has been achieved up to a suitable degree. This is an example of a tracheal stenosis 3 centimeters distal to the vocal cords. Incisions are being given through electrocautery knife. And then the balloon has been inserted into the stenotic segment, as this is too small for the balloon to be inserted into. And here's the end result, where you can see almost more than 90% of dilatation has helped in getting rid of the lesion. Here you can see via rigid bronchoscope, the lower end of the tracheal lesion. This is balloon dilatation has been done and adequate patency achieved. For tight circumferential strictures, radial incisions can be helpful to make, are helpful to be made prior to balloon dilatation. There are no clear guidelines on when an incision should be used or when it shouldn't be. It is often operator dependent. In severe stenosis with impending airway closure or repeat dilatation for a stenotic lesion that was initially unresponsive to prior dilatation, radial incisions should be taken with an electrocautery knife or laser. They can be used using NDAG laser or using high power density to avoid collateral tissue damage, a potassium titanyl phosphate laser, or an electrocautery knife, which is safe to use the blend or the coagulation mode rather than the cut mode in order to assure hemostasis. If used appropriately, most experts believe that it may prevent complications such as tearing or rupture due to dilatation itself, particularly when the stricture is very tight. Now I'll come down to some case series which are evaluating the balloon dilatation in non-malignant tracheobronchial stenosis. Here there are certain authors which have shown, including the pediatric population, the percentage of the success which is immediately seen after the procedure and in long term, with a mean follow-up of almost 2 to 3 years. Ferretti had 16 patients with 68% success rate immediately and a long-term follow-up showing 56% persistence. Lee et al. Had 15 patients, 73% success rate, which stayed the same in a long-term follow-up. Hebra et al. Used a pediatric population in which it was a bigger immediate success rate as compared to a longer term. And the Mathur and Chesky study showed 71% success rate, which stayed the same in a long-term procedure. In non-malignant settings, where the tracheobronchial stenosis are due to the benign cause, the success rate is seen to be greater immediately as well as sometimes long-term, sometimes even needing repeat dilatations. This is a good paper published in the European Journal of Cardiothoracic Surgery, in which they have done a long-term follow-up up to 600 days of a single center study, in which they have shown that around 14 patients that needed balloon dilatation for the lung transplant, needing those with malignancy or having post mechanical ventilation strictures. Some needed even stent insertion in terms of lung transplantation and also malignancy. And you can see the total follow-up days is almost 600 days. And if you look at those with malignancy and lung transplant, they didn't have good outcome in the follow-up of around 600 days. Whereas the ones with benign disease are all doing well. The pulmonary function test before and after balloon dilatation showed the advantage of doing balloon dilatation in helping achieve a better lung function post the procedure. You can see it's the FEV1 keeps getting better even a month after. Here you can see the forced expiratory volume percentage changes in the type of therapies that are given for tracheobronchial stenosis during a 600-day follow-up. You can see every time a therapy was given, the lung function was better. Here even a stent was introduced and then patient continued to do well. A review of literature of adult the studies reviewing the literature in adult population of bronchoscopic balloon dilatation. Here you can see most of the patients that were non-malignant have all improved and have done well. The ones which are malignant is more of a procedure in which palliation is achieved. In the series of the patients that we spoke about, the series which was discussed, the total 35 patients, and they most of them improved in terms of their outcome. And the ones who were deceased were because of the disease, not because of the issue of the stenosis. Coming to complications, certain complications due to balloon dilation itself are unusual. The symptoms such as chest pain are common. Periprocedural bronchospasm or atelectasis also have been reported. Excessive balloon inflation may lacerate or rupture the airway. Hemorrhage, pneumothorax, pneumomediastinum, and mediastinitis are very rare, however, can be seen. So you need to dilate carefully and do not try to over-dilate or overachieve a certain pressure that is needed to keep you away from these complications. Lacerations often heal spontaneously after conservative treatment. You do not need to usually go in for a surgical approach to repair these lacerations. This was a interesting case report by Dr. Atul Mehta and colleagues, in which post-balloon bronchoplasty, there was a negative pressure pulmonary edema seen in the airways. Here you can see post-dilatation, there was some amount of bleeding seen and petechiae in the airway wall. To summarize this case study, they said that the simultaneous occurrence of bloodstain secretions and petechial tracheobronchial hemorrhage is rarely recognized as a potential complication of transient intentional occlusion of the airways. It was the simultaneous occurrence of both of these phenomena suggested different degrees of injury in a common pathogenic spectrum. They postulated that sustained complete occlusion of airway produces variable degrees of mechanical disruption of the bronchial and alveolar structure or vasculature that lead to the development of negative pressure, pulmonary edema, and tracheobronchial hemorrhage. Follow-up, assess patients clinically approximately 2 weeks post-procedure. Some experts want to perform PFTs to determine whether there's been an improvement in the ventilatory function. However, a follow-up flexible bronchoscopy and a CT would be more preferable and would depend on case to case as to if both are needed. Otherwise, a flexible bronchoscopic evaluation of the airways gives you a very good idea as to how long the therapy is going to go on, as well as whether the need for dilatation has come so soon. Unless this patient has signs and symptoms obviously suggestive of the significant residual stenosis. To conclude, balloon bronchoplasty is a safe and simple, quick, effective, as well as repeatable method to obtain greater airway patency. Symptomatic impact is immediate in most. You can see patients who have come in with stridor or have been intubated. Post procedure can be extubated on table and are breathing on room air. The equipment is readily available and supplies are inexpensive, and the balloons are reusable. The intervention may be all that is required or can be used as an adjunct to other therapies. If not sufficient, it can at least allow time to plan for the next levels of intervention. For example, vascular surgery needing end-to-end re-anastomosis. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. Very well-defined and well-presented talk. So we have some questions for you here.
Yes.
So we'll take it one by one.
Yeah, sure.
Sir, what are the pros and cons of bougie dilation?
So bougie dilation was performed earlier, and nowadays with the advent of the flexible bronchoscope, we usually don't use the bougie dilatation, as under vision, we are able to use the balloons. We can control the dilatation. We can use a variety of sizes of the balloons, and can be done in real time. Whereas in bougies, which is used more likely in the esophageal strictures than tracheal strictures. Tracheal strictures, they were used more in the pediatric population in the past, and some used it even in the adult population, but it was used only in those where your balloon dilatations or a balloon dilator is not available.
Okay, sure. So, sir, the next question is, what do you prefer in your practice, a rigid or a flexible bronchoscope?
I would prefer a flexible bronchoscope to most of the lesions. A rigid bronchoscope is needed or can be even used only in those lesions which are present in the distal airways. For example, a lower end of the trachea or even in the main bronchi, but cannot be used in the lesions which are more proximal, say in the upper end of the trachea. A laryngeal mask airway can do the trick in these situations, or if you are able to do it under local anesthesia and mild sedation also, that is also usually done under flexible bronchoscopy, and the patient can get away without using general anesthesia.
Sure, sir. Another question is, what are the different causes of central airway stenosis?
So, like I described in my slides, the causes can be divided into malignant and those which are not malignant. The causes which are malignant would mean either the malignancy is inside the airway or around it. And the ones which are the structures which are around the airways, which are also involved in malignancy, can cause some amount of obstruction from outside the airway, causing us airway stricture extrinsically. Non-iatrogenic causes would be infectious causes like TB, or iatrogenic causes like post-intubation or post-tracheostomy tracheal strictures. And certain auto-inflammatory or autoimmune causes like Wegener's or sarcoid can also present with airway stenosis.
Sure, sir. Another question is, what provides a better visibility during the procedure, a direct vision or a fluoroscopy?
Direct vision, definitely, as you are able to see whether the dilatation is happening real time. Fluoroscopy would be better in only those lesions where you're not able to visualize the distal end very clearly of the stricture.
Okay. And also, sir, how is the balloon size determined, like during the procedure?
It can be done via either by CT guide, the CT scan of the prior procedure, pre-procedure can also tell you the size of the lesion, or when you are doing a routine airway evaluation using the bronchoscope, you can compare the size of the lesion to your bronchoscope. If you're able to pass the bronchoscope through, or whether there's any difficulty in passing through it, then you can, looking at that, comparing it to your diameter of the bronchoscope, you can determine the size of the balloons to be used.
Sure, sir. Another question is, what are the possible complications of balloon bronchoplasty?
As I just discussed in the slides, complications usually are few and are not very common. Those involving, so if the patient has undergone surgery prior to the strictures being developed, for example, lung transplant, then there's a risk of the stricture dilatation leading to an airway fracture. That can be a complication, but it's not usually seen. You need to dilate with caution. Other complications such as pneumothorax, hemorrhage, or pneumomediastinum can also be seen if there has been some amount of mucosal tear and some amount of escape into the mediastinum or the into the hemithorax. And like one rare case that I had shown, which showed that pulmonary edema due to negative pressure is also a complication of balloon dilatation. However, it is extremely rare.
So one last question for you. So are there any specifications for guide wire placement?
There are no specifications as such. You can use the guide wire placement or you can do without the guide wire, depending on how you're comfortable with using the balloons.
Okay. So, Dr. Ahuja, I think these were all the questions. Any message to our viewers watching us here?
Balloon dilatation is often an underutilized procedure, in my opinion. We don't come across the patients which are actually having a lot of breathlessness, especially having unilateral V's or strider, are usually not evaluated earlier. They should be evaluated earlier. They should be either done radiologically or a bronchoscopic evaluation of the airways to see if this is done. Secondly, even in TB, you would want to probably visualize the airways once to see whether there's any endobronchial spread of TB. Usually, we end up treating the patients based on sputum smear sample or demonstrating the mycobacteria, as well as a radiological assessment, which shows that the patient is suffering from TB. Many times, endobronchial TB is not seen on radiology and needs to be only visualized with the bronchoscope to understand whether there is some extent of endobronchial invasion with TB. These endobronchial tubercular cases don't do well, and if they have got a stenotic segment, often require repeat dilatations. And if not done early, these end up even actually, you know, losing that part of the lung due to the stenosis, and has got a pretty bad outcome. So doing, keeping in mind the etiologies and the causes of central airway obstruction or airway obstruction as a whole, one should always think of airway stenosis whenever a patient is breathless and not responding to conventional therapy.
Sure, sir. I think, again, I think I would like to thank you on behalf of DocPlexus for sharing your valuable insights and expertise over this topic. We're very grateful for your support, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you for giving me this platform to disseminate this important information regarding balloon dilatation. And I hope it was very useful to our viewers. And most of them who have heard us now are pretty, have understood the procedure as well as will be able to now relate to airway stenosis much more in their patients than before.
I would also like to thank all our viewers for watching us and being present throughout the session. Do let us know if you have any topic suggestions for us that we could take up. If you wish to be a part of our expert panel, please do reach out to us and write to us what you would like to speak about. Thank you for your support to DocPlexus.